أعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، له الملك وله الحمد، يحيي ويميت وهو على كل شيء قدير وإليه المصير. We mentioned that in previous verses, فَإِنْ حَاجُّوكَ فَقُلْ أَسْلَمْتُ وَجْهِيَ لِلَّهِ وَمَنِ اتَّبَعَنِ وَقُلْ لِلَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ وَالْأُمِّيِّينَ أَسْلَمْتُمْ فَإِنْ أَسْلَمُوا فَقَدْ اهْتَدَوْا وَإِنْ تَوَلَّوْا فَإِنَّمَا عَلَيْكَ الْبَلَاغُ وَاللَّهُ بَصِيرٌ بِالْعِبَادِ. And we said that this beautiful ayah states that after stating that Islam is the religion that Allah accepts, subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the previous ayah, inna ad-deena 'inda Allahi al-Islam, the religion in the sight of Allah to be accepted is Islam, submission to Him. وَمَن يَبْتَغِ غَيْرَ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا فَلَن يُقْبَلَ مِنْهُ. In another site in Surah Al Imran, وَمَن يَبْتَغِ غَيْرَ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا فَلَن يُقْبَلَ مِنْهُ. In verse number 85, whoever takes other than Islam as a way of life, it will not be accepted from him. وَمَا اخْتَلَفَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ إِلَّا مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَهُمُ الْعِلْمُ بَغْيًا بَيْنَهُمْ. The differences between the people who were given the book only came after they were given the knowledge of the book as a form of بَغْيًا بَيْنَهُمْ. And we explained the word بَغْيًا بَيْنَهُمْ as تحاسد, envy amongst them. تباغض, hatred of one another. And تدابر, I will not take it from you no matter what you say because it's coming from you. والعياذ بالله. So they personalize their conflicts. While we as Muslims, we should take the good wherever it's coming from. If I have differences with somebody, if I see that somebody has some defects in their behavior, if they are saying something righteous, I should take it from them, regardless of my assessment of them as a holistic person, because we are not to judge each other. بَغْيًا بَيْنَهُمْ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَإِنْ حَاجُّوكَ, if they argue with you, فَقُلْ أَسْلَمْتُ وَجْهِيَ لِلَّهِ أَخْلَصْتُ عِبَادَتِي لِلَّهِ, I purified my all my forms of worship for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَنِ اتَّبَعَنِي, and whoever follows me does the same. They purify their hearts, they submit their face and all their forms of worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Yusuf says, قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أدعو إلى الله على بصيرة أنا ومن اتبعني. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in another site orders the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to say, this is my path. I am inviting to the way of Allah on a clear cut message to me and to whoever follows me. وَقُلْ لِلَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ وَالْأُمِّيِّينَ أَسْلَمْتُمْ, and ask those who were given the book and who are illiterate, who are non-lettered people, have you submitted to the way of Allah? فَإِنْ أَسْلَمُوا فَقَدْ اهْتَدَوْا, if they submit to the way of Allah, then they have been guided. وَإِنْ تَوَلَّوْا فَإِنَّمَا عَلَيْكَ الْبَلَاغُ, and if they turn away, all your job, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is nothing but to convey the message. وَاللَّهُ بَصِيرٌ بِالْعِبَادِ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all aware, all seeing of whom of His servants is deserving guidance and whom of His servants do not deserve guidance and they lead themselves astray. And we said that this verse was an order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to Prophet Muhammad to spread the message. Based on this ayah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started sending letters inviting people to Islam from east and west, from north and south. Arab and Ajam, whether they are Arabs, whether they are non-Arabs, Persians, Romans, all these people received invitations from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to join the Muslim Ummah. And we concluded the last recording we had with beautiful hadith, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ لَا يَسْمَعُ بِي أَحَدٌ مِّنْ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ يَهُودِي وَلَا نَصْرَانِي وَمَاتَ وَلَمْ يُؤْمِن بِالَّذِي أُرْسِلْتُ بِهِ إِلَّا كَانَ مِنْ أَهْلِ النَّارِ. Nobody, Allah, the Prophet ﷺ is swearing by Allah, who has control over his own soul, that no one would ever hear of him, be that a Jew or a Christian, and chooses not to follow what Prophet Muhammad ﷺ was sent with, except they will be the permanent inhabitants of hellfire. وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ. And we told the story of the Jewish boy who was helping the Prophet ﷺ, and how the Prophet tried to invite him to the way of Islam right before his death, and he took permission from his father to do so. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَكْفُرُونَ بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ وَيَقْتُلُونَ النَّبِيِّينَ بِغَيْرِ حَقٍّ وَيَقْتُلُونَ الَّذِينَ يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْقِسْطِ مِنَ النَّاسِ فَبَشِّرْهُمْ بِعَذَابٍ أَلِيمٍ. Those who slay or kill the prophets of Allah. And we said before that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would never allow any people to kill any of his messengers. While Banu Israel were popular for, were known for killing and slaying the prophets. And the difference we said between a prophet and a messenger is that the prophet would be reviving, is a pious person that receives revelation without a book, would be reviving the last message on the last messenger before him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَكْفُرُونَ بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ, those who reject the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَيَقْتُلُونَ النَّبِيِّينَ بِغَيْرِ حَقٍّ, and kill the prophets without any right to do so, وَيَقْتُلُونَ الَّذِينَ يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْقِسْطِ مِنَ النَّاسِ, and they slay those who order justice amongst the people, فَبَشِّرْهُمْ بِعَذَابٍ أَلِيمٍ, give them the tidings of a grievous torment. And we said there are multiple sites of beautiful language in this verse. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَكْفُرُونَ بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ, we said that the difference between الَّذِينَ يَكْفُرُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ يَكْفُرُونَ بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is غايب, and we see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his signs, in his ayat. So people who reject the ayat of Allah are worse, even because even the ayat of Allah that are clear cut before their eyes, they are rejecting. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَكْفُرُونَ بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ وَيَقْتُلُونَ النَّبِيِّينَ بِغَيْرِ حَقٍّ, and they slay the prophets without any right to do so. Not only al-anbiya, but they also slay those amongst people who order justice. Al-amirina bil-ma'roof wal-nahina 'anil munkar, fabashshirhum. Al-bushra usually comes glad tidings, carrying out a good piece of news. But to give us and to give them the shock, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, fabashshirhum. What kind of glad tidings, O Allah? What kind of good news, O Allah? بِعَذَابٍ أَلِيمٍ. Similar to in Surah Al-Kahf, وَإِن يَسْتَغِيثُوا يُغَاثُوا بِمَاءٍ كَالْمُهْلِ يَشْوِي الْوُجُوهِ. When they ask, begging for water, they are given water. You say, oh, that's very good. وَلَكِنُّ, it is boiling water that charcoals their faces. وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ, that burns their faces off. So this is the beauty of the language of the Quran, to give you a feel of the kind of torment that they are given. فَبَشِّرْهُمْ بِعَذَابٍ أَلِيمٍ, so carry the glad tidings to them of a grievous torment. We also mentioned that the hadith of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to Abi Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah, when he asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, قلت يا رسول الله أي الناس أشد عذابا يوم القيامة, Who of the people would receive the grievous of torments on the day of judgment? Qala, the Prophet ﷺ said, Rajulun qatala nabiyya, a man who killed a prophet. Aw qatala man amara bil ma'ruf wa naha 'anil munkar, or one who slays a person who promotes that which is right and forbids that which is sinful. Thumma tala al-ayah. The Prophet ﷺ recited this ayah, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَكْفُرُونَ بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ وَيَقْتُلُونَ النَّبِيِّينَ بِغَيْرِ حَقٍّ وَيَقْتُلُونَ الَّذِينَ يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْقِسْطِ مِنَ النَّاسِ فَبَشِّرْهُمْ بِعَذَابٍ أَلِيمٍ. Then he continued to tell Abu Ubaidah, يَا أَبَا عُبَيْدَةَ قَتَلَتْ بَنُو إِسْرَائِيلَ 43 نَبِيًّا من أول النهار في ساعة واحدة. That Banu Israel, the descendants of Israel, they killed 43 prophets in 1 hour of the day. And when 170 pious people came to them and blamed them for that grievous action, they killed them all by the end of the day. فقام 170 رجلا من بني إسرائيل يأمرون بالمعروف وينهونهم عن المنكر فقتلوهم جميعا. They killed them all. من آخر النهار من ذلك اليوم. Those are the ones that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning in the verse. أولئك الذين حبطت أعمالهم في الدنيا والآخرة. Those are the ones whose deeds in this world and in the hereafter become completely fruitless, become completely void. وَمَا لَهُم مِّن نَّاصِرِينَ. Who will support them against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The next ayah, أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا نَصِيبًا مِّنَ الْكِتَابِ يُدْعَوْنَ إِلَى كِتَابِ اللَّهِ لِيَحْكُمَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثم يتولى فريق منهم وهم معرضون. We said alam. Alhamza is a question mark, and lam is a negation word. Have you not tara, seen, ila alladhina, to those, alam tara ila alladhina utu, they were given. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yu'ti al-hikmata man yasha. Utu means they were given a blessing that was bestowed on them. They were not only given, it's a blessing that was bestowed on them by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alam tara ila alladhina utu nasiban min al-kitab. We said only a portion of the book. Why is it called a portion of the book? Because of their behavior with the book. It kept on trimming the book off, so they ended up with only one portion of the book. How did they do that? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Ma'idah, يُحَرِّفُونَ الْكَلِمَ عَنْ مَوَاضِعِهِ. They deviate the words off of their meanings. This is one technique that makes them lose portion of the book. Number two, in the same ayah, وَنَسُوا حَظًّا مِمَّا ذُكِّرُوا بِهِ. And they have forgotten a portion of what they were reminded of. So number one, deviate the meaning. Number two, forget. Number three, in Surah Al-Baqarah, وَإِنَّ فَرِيقًا مِّنْهُمْ لَيَكْتُمُونَ الْحَقَّ وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. They hide it behind their backs. They suppress it. They don't convey it to the people. And lastly, in Surah Al-Imran, وَإِنَّ مِنْهُمْ لَفَرِيقًا يُلْوُونَ أَلْسِنَتَهُمْ بِالْكِتَابِ لِتَحْسَبُوهُ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ وَمَا هُوَ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ وَيَقُولُونَ هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ وَمَا هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ. They write their own words and claim that this is part of the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are the four techniques by which Ahlul Kitab, they ended up with only portion of the book. Tahrif, deviating the meaning. Forgetting, hiding, and writing their own verses and claiming that it is part of the book. أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا نَصِيبًا مِّنَ الْكِتَابِ يُدْعَوْنَ إِلَى كِتَابِ اللَّهِ لِيَحْكُمَ بَيْنَهُمْ. And we said that this refers to the story of two honorable people from Banu Khaybar. when they went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asking his arbitration when they committed adultery, to find a way to save them from being stoned per the ruling of the Torah. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them, why don't you go back to the Torah? Don't you have this ruling in the Torah? Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them exactly which part of the Torah that they can read. And when one of their ahbar, one of their scholars, one of their rabbis, his name was Abdullah ibn Suriya, started reading the Torah, he skipped the verse that tells about stoning. But Abdullah ibn Salam, who used to be one of the ahbar of Yahud, one of the rabbis of Yahud, happened to be present in that session, and he knew the Torah very well. So he said, no, you skipped an ayah here. Go back and read it. So they went back to Khaybar without gaining what they were looking for, and diverting and deviating away from accepting the arbitration of the revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا نَصِيبًا مِنَ الْكِتَابِ يُدْعَوْنَ إِلَى كِتَابِ اللَّهِ لِيَحْكُمَ بَيْنَهُمْ. They are invited to the book of Allah to rule amongst them. ثُمَّ يَتَوَلَّى فَرِيقٌ مِّنْهُمْ. A group of them would deviate away, would turn away. وَهُمْ مُعْرِضُونَ. ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّهُمْ قَالُوا. That's because they said, لَن تَمَسَّنَ النَّارُ إِلَّا أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَاتٍ. We will not be touched by the hellfire except for a few days. وَغَرَّهُمْ فِي دِينِهِمْ مَا كَانُوا يَفْتَرُونَ. Their forgeries in their religion deviated them based on what they invented into their religion. And we said that they claimed that the hellfire would only touch them for a few days. Some of them claimed that this world would last for only 7,000 years. For every 1,000 year, we will be punished by only 1 year, 1 day. So only a total of 7 days with a touch of fire. You can take it. Because we are the sons of Yaqub, who is favored to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is no way that Allah would torment us. This is one saying. The other saying was that we will be touched only by the hellfire for 40 days, equivalent to the time that they were worshipping the calf that Samirai made for them while Musa was invited to go worship Allah on the mount. And they said that we will be only touched by fire for 40 days. After that, we will be all shifted to Jannah and we will be replaced by Muslims in hellfire. Walayadu billah. So these are all claims. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Baqarah said, قُلْ أَتَّخَذْتُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَهْدًا فَلَنْ يُخْلِفَ اللَّهُ عَهْدًا. Have you taken a covenant on Allah to torment you with a touch of fire for only a few days? أَمْ تَقُولُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Well, you are saying and claiming on Allah that which you have no knowledge of. And here, وَقَالُوا لَنْ تَمَسَّنَ النَّارُ إِلَّا أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَاتٍ. Countable days. Would be only touched by hellfire for a few countable days. وَغَرَّهُمْ فِي دِينِهِمْ مَا كَانُوا يَفْتَرُونَ. الغرور, we said, is a طمع فيما لا يصح. Hope and wishes in what is inapplicable, inachievable. We said that I don't study and I expect to be ahead of my class, to score the highest. This is called gharur. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls a shaitan al-gharur because he deceives people into believing in that which is inachievable. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Fatir, Ya ayyuhan nas, يا أيها الناس إن وعد الله حق فلا تغرنكم الحياة الدنيا ولا يغرنكم بالله الغرور. O people, the promise of Allah is all truthful, all to be fulfilled. So don't be deceived and deviated by gharur of this worldly life, and do not be deceived by the deception of the shaitan, which is gharur. Allah calls a shaitan al-gharur because he is the biggest source of gharur, tempting people to do the wrong, and وَيُمَنِّيهِمْ, and he gives them false hopes. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Ibrahim, وَقَالَ الشَّيْطَانُ لَمَّا قُضِيَ الْأَمْرُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَعَدَكُمْ وَعَدَ الْحَقِّ وَوَعَدْتُكُمْ فَأَخْلَفْتُكُمْ وَمَا كَانَ لِي عَلَيْكُمْ مِنْ سُلْطَانٍ إِلَّا أَنْ دَعَوْتُكُمْ فَاسْتَجَبْتُمْ لِي فَلَا تَلُومُونِي وَلُومُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. Do not blame me. Blame yourselves. All I did was invited you. I didn't twist your arm. I didn't force you to follow me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised you the righteous promise, the promise that He, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, would fulfill. While Satan is promising us al-gharur, unfulfillable promises. And on the day of judgment, he will say, well, I didn't force you to follow me. مَا أَنَا بِمُصْرِخِكُمْ. I can't save you. وَمَا أَنْتُمْ بِمُصْرِخِي. You can't save me. إِنِّي كَفَرْتُ بِمَا أَشْرَكْتُمُونِ مِنْ قَبْلِ. I reject that you assumed me as a partner with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He rejects that on the Day of Judgment. That's why in Al-Imran, the next ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَكَيْفَ إِذَا جَمَعْنَاهُمْ لِيَوْمِ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. How about if we gather them for a day about which there's no doubt? وَوُفِّيَتْ كُلُّ نَفْسٍ مَا كَسَبَتْ. Every soul would be rewarded and paid back whatever it earned in this worldly life. A time when we have a choice. This is the time we have a choice. On the Day of Judgment, we have no choice. Choice is taken away. It is the time for judging, not choosing. فَكَيْفَ إِذَا مَجَّمَعْنَاهُمْ لِيَوْمٍ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ وَوُفِّيَتْ كُلُّ نَفْسٍ مَا كَسَبَتْ. Every soul would be rewarded and paid back whatever it earned. وَهُمْ لَا يُظْلَمُونَ. They will never be treated with injustice. قُلِ اللَّهُمَّ مَالِكَ الْمُلْكِ. Isn't that the day that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala owns? Does He have any other owners with Him on that day? قُلِ اللَّهُمَّ مَالِكَ الْمُلْكِ تُؤْتِي الْمُلْكَ مَنْ تَشَاءُ وتنزع الملك ممن تشاء وتعز من تشاء وتذل من تشاء بيدك الخير إنك على كل شيء قدير. Say, O Allah, say, O Allah, قل اللهم مالك الملك, Lord of all dominions, تؤتي الملك من تشاء. You bestow, again تؤتي الحكمة, أوتوا الكتاب, تؤتي الملك من تشاء. It is not to give. You bestow the ruling of the dominion to whoever you wish. وتنزع الملك ممن تشاء. And you pull away the ruling from whoever you wish. وَتُعِزُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ. You exalt whomever you wish. وَتُذِلُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ. And you abase whoever you wish. بِيَدِكَ الْخَيْرُ. Allah has nothing to offer except for goodness. Whether we perceive it as goodness, khayr, or we perceive it as shar, it is khayr all the time. We'll explain that in a minute, inshallah. وتعز من تشاء وتذل من تشاء بيدك الخير إنك على كل شيء قدير. For you, O Allah, is all capable of all things. Look at the beauty of the ayat. And this is one of the strongest ayat of Surah Al-Imran. We need to differentiate between milk, mulk, and malakut. Milk is ownership. I own my clothes, I own my car, I own a house, possessions that man has. This is called milk. I possess books, cars, any possessions a human has. Do we have ownership over these possessions except with the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? No. Only with the permission of Allah. Only with the permission of Allah. How about mulk? Mulk is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ownership over human beings with whatever they own. So this is called mulk. قُلِ اللَّهُمَّ مَالِكَ الْمُلْكِ Dominion. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has lordship over all dominions. How about malakut? Anybody knows what's the difference between mulk and malakut? Huh? Malakut is whatever is unseen, like angels. So malakut is the position or control that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has over things that we as human beings cannot see. This is called malakut. Remember the ayah? Ibrahim alayhi salam, while he was looking for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah says, وَكَذَلِكَ نُرِي إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَكَذَلِكَ نُرِي إِبْرَاهِيمَ مَلَكُوتِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَلِيَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُوقِنِينَ See the understanding of the Quran? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't show Ibrahim السماوات والأرض only. No. He showed him ملكوت السماوات والأرض. He showed him things in the samawat and earth that we regular human beings cannot see. He showed him المجرات. He showed him the planets. He showed him stars that we cannot see. He showed him the creation that's happening in السماوات والأرض. Similar to the trip of Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. What was the time of Isra al-Mi'raj? It was at the peak of crisis in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you think about it, the 10th year was the year of grief. 10th year of Ba'atha, after the first encounter with Jibreel. This is before Hijrah. We're talking about Mecca time. After all the doors were shut, there was no more hope for anybody else to join Islam. Getting out of a boycott that was imposed on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Banu Hashim for 3 years. A consequence of the suffering of these 3 years was that he lost his uncle, the external support. He lost his wife, the internal support. After that, in Shawwal of that year, what did he do? He went to At-Ta'if. What did the people of Ta'if do to him? How did they treat him? And he thought that these people would have soft hearts based on the fact that they live in a lush piece of land, which is uncommon in the Arab Peninsula, full of plants and full of palm trees and producing. He thought that their hearts might be soft because they are leading more of a luxurious life than the rest of the Arab Peninsula. How did they treat him? So this is addition to the crisis. Remember the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, إِن لَمْ يَكُمْ بِكَ عَلَيَّ غَضَبٌ فَلَا أُبَالِي If you, Allah, has no wrath with me, I do not care what people do to me. For your mercy is much wider to me than the mercy of all human beings. And between that point and between the Hijrah is the time that Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj happened. What was the value of the trip of Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is exposing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to malakut as-samawati wal-ard. Allah is exposing him to malakut as-samawati wal-ard. Remember the experience that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam had during Hijrah. He's expelled out of his town, being followed and chased. How steadfast was he? What did he say to Abu Bakr in the ghar? What did he say? La tahzan, inna Allah ma'ana. Well, he's been exposed to the malakut as-samawati wal-ard. So he knows. Now he has thabatun min Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The same that happened with Ibrahim previously. That's why when Ibrahim found Allah, he was thrown into fire. Did he care? Did that flicker him? Did that make him shake? When Suraqa was following the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and Abu Bakr, did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam bother to even look behind and see who's following him? No, we're beyond that stage. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam has been exposed to malakut as-samawati wal-ard. So the difference between milk, ownership, possession. Milk, mulk, that's owned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the malakut is what is unseen to regular human beings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exposes that to some of his messengers only. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قُلِ اللَّهُمَّ. It is a very unique form of the language where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is called on by Allahumma, O Allah. No other name in the Arabic language, you can add an M at the end and this would be a calling on. We never say Muhammadumma, no. We never say Aliyumma, no. We say, Ay Ali, Ay Muhammad. The only unique noun that is called upon by Allahumma. Allahumma. Qul Allahumma malik al-mulk. Tu'ti al-mulk man tasha'. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the power to give the ruling to whoever he wishes. Wa tanzi'u al-mulka mimman tasha'. What is tanzi'? Naz'a. What is naz'a? Pulling with hardship. This is different from take away. Take away al-mulk from whoever you need. No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, look at the accuracy of the language. Tanzi'u al-mulka mimman tasha'. Whoever is in ruling, it's not very easy to take it away from them. Especially when it comes to royalties. Anybody who's in a status of ruling, it is like pulling teeth, as we call it. تَنْزِعُ الْمُلْكَ. Pulling with hardship. مِمَّنْ تَشَاءُ وَتُعِزُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, bear in mind that al-izz wal-dhul doesn't have to do with who has the ruling and who doesn't. Because by pulling the ruling from somebody, there is a mutual process of izz and dhul. Izz to some people who have been suffering with the unfair ruling. And dhul to those who are what we call bitanatul malik, people who are the understructure of the kingdom. The malik doesn't rule by himself. There is a whole body of understructure. What we call ad-dawla al-amiqa, the deep state. The deep state. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at the time that He's giving izz to those who have been suffering and oppressed, He is giving dhul to those who have been oppressing. So how can this be a khayr? بِيَدِكَ الْخَيْر. Because if the ruling person who's been oppressing, that's his chance to repent and go back to Allah. That's his chance to check with himself and look in the mirror and say, oh, I have been very oppressive. I've been unfair. And take a lesson from this and go repent back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَتُعِزُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ وَتُذِلُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ بِيَدِكَ الْخَيْرِ إِنَّكَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. You are all capable of all things. Inshallah, we'll resume next time. جزاكم الله خيرا. اللهم اجعل القرآن العظيم ربيع قلوبنا. اللهم علمنا من القرآن ما جهلنا وذكرنا منه ما نسينا وما نسينا يا رب العالمين. اللهم اجعل القرآن العظيم لنا في هذه الدنيا دستورا، واجعله لنا في القبر ونيسا، واجعله لنا على الصراط نورا.